Hey everyone, welcome back to Lunch and Life. This month we've been talking about stress and transition. And in the first week we talked about the connection to the mind. The second week we discussed about the foods and our gut and how it affects stress affects it. And this week we're going to share with you why this is so important for you to take care of the brain and the gut. Are you ready?
I'm ready. Are you ready?
Let's do it. Hi everyone, I'm Sharon Holand, Gelfand, a functional, holistic, and lifestyle nutritionist supporting busy, health-minded women get to the root of their most common health complaints with at-home testing and flexible food choices so they have more energy, feel great, and have less stress.
And I am Robin Joy Meyers. I am a former molecular geneticist turned fear strategist, and I help empower women to embrace change and believe in the three C's of life, which is choice, chance, and change, that you always have a choice to take a chance to make a change.
So, you know, you and I were talking before we started this episode about the fact that this month is an anniversary for 9/11.
And 19 years.
I know.
Hard to believe.
It really is hard to believe. You know, just, do you remember where you were?
You know, I know exactly where I was. Exactly. So I was, believe it or not, I was in Virginia and I played tennis a lot. My kids were little and I was going across the American Legion Bridge passing Langley to play tennis with this group of women that I play tennis with, and heard the news on the radio. And actually my husband had called me saying, something's going on. I don't think you should be going into Maryland right now. We got across. I mean, you're on the bridge and traffic on the Beltway. And all the mothers were like, something's up and we're leaving. So literally got there, turned around. I went to the public school to grab my oldest. And then I went to this private school to grab the younger two. And the public school had a lot of kids, and their kids were in, their parents were military kids. So I remember it was just really like strange, and they didn't want to tell the kids, but they didn't really want the kids there. And so I tried to help out in the office for a little bit, but I didn't want to stay there. I wanted to get to the other school to get my kids. And a friend of mine who had her three children in this private school, and that was next to a CIA building, by the way.
Wow.
So she broke her ankle. And so I remember saying, I got your kids, stay at your home. And so literally I picked up her three and my other two with my other one. So six kids in my Suburban at the time. So typical. And ended up back at her house, and just eyes were glued on the TV all day long.
Yeah.
All day.
Yeah.
And just, what about you?
My kids were in elementary school at the time. I think they were all in elementary school, and I was at the gym. I went to the gym in the morning, and I'm, you know, on the treadmill, like doing my thing, and they have TVs on everywhere. And I just remember looking up and seeing the plane go into the first building and being like, what? You know, because you kind of look, it was so surreal.
Right.
And I, you know, there wasn't any sounds. I didn't have my headphones because I had just broken them, of course. And everybody's gasping and talking and murmuring. And all I kept thinking was, I have to get home. I have to get home. Like, what is going on here? Because my dad had his business where he was a heating and plumbing contractor. So his men are always in the World Trade Center. He was always in the World Trade Center. I had just been there 2 days before. And my cousin worked in the World Trade Center. So it was like, I have to get home. By the time I got home, the second plane hit, you know, the buildings were coming down. And like you, we were just glued to the TV. But what I remember even more about it was the next day, because they shut down like all the trains. There was no in or out. You weren't allowed to go, right? Everything was grounded. And you weren't even allowed to take a train. Like the bridges were closed. The trains were closed. You couldn't get into the city, trying to get in touch with people. But I remember the next morning, still in a surreal state, but having to drive past the train station. And there were cars in the parking lot.
Oh, people never got home.
People who didn't survive. But I didn't make, I remember seeing it and thinking, huh, that's odd. And then a little bit later thinking, oh my God, those people never made it home, or they're stuck in the city. And it was just, It was so eerie. It was just so eerie. And, you know, still being in the city now, they have the lights as a, you know, the commemorative lights, the beams.
Right.
It just goes to show like how fragile life is.
It really does, you know, and the world really did change. I mean, everything really did change.
It's amazing because you're right, like the world's changed and then we move on. And now here we are with coronavirus.
Right.
And the world is changing again.
Right. The world is changing again. And the world can shut down.
Yeah, exactly. And not just, it's not just like New York City or DC or, you know, where the planes hit. It's the world.
Yeah.
It's shutting down and our perceptions and our beliefs about everything are being questioned. And that's exacerbating the stress and the anxiety of what we're all going through. And with this month of transition, there's just so much that we're not even aware of, right? The unconsciously incompetent of not being aware of all of it and what it's doing to our bodies.
You know, it's interesting you say that too, because I did watch the beginning of the news this morning. And of course, they're doing the reading of the names and bells and moments of silence. And interesting how they're trying to keep the, preserve the respect and the dignity of the day, I guess that's the right way to say it. But also in this time of the coronavirus, right? I mean, New York almost seemed crowded, showing downtown and by the world, you know, by the memorial, the, what do you call that, that they created?
The pools, the
yeah, the pool.
The reflecting pools.
Thank you. That. Which seemed a little crowded, like they didn't have the big stage or anything, but people had their masks on and stuff like that. Yet they showed Shanksville, PA, where the chairs are further apart because they can. You know, they can do that. They can have it further apart. And obviously there's more space to do that. But just the stress of that, and then you look at what we talked about of this month and how to handle the stress and the overwhelm and how to really deal with these conversations, because it brings a whole nother element. And I think a whole nother level of consciousness to how do we have the conversations and how do we keep the conversations real?
Right.
You know, right. Age appropriate and real though, without, I was listening to Brene Brown actually, like how not to instill the panic, how to make sure that the conversations are open and honest, but to realize and to establish that what is safe and what feels unsafe. You know, there's a difference of being uncertain, but knowing that there's a difference of uncertainty and being unsafe.
Yeah. It's and the conversations need to be had, right? It's kind of like when, even with your kids, even more importantly, you know, there's always like the sex talk and the drinking talk and the drugs talk. It's living life now in this new world. And, you know, we know that the millennials, especially the younger generation, the Gen Y, the Gen Z, the all of them are experiencing more stress than you and I have ever experienced in our lives.
A whole new layer. I mean, who would imagine, right?
Yeah. It's
different layers.
And that leads to mental health issues. It leads to physical health issues. So everything that we've been talking about, as you were saying, from week one and week two of the hows and things to start paying attention to, the why it's so important is that, you know, especially physically, it's really important because stress and anxiety can trigger so much in our bodies. And they'll, you know, you can go from being so nervous and anxious that you lose your appetite to getting constipated and having diarrhea and indigestion and gas. And it also limits your body's ability to be able to absorb nutrients. And these are things that we don't think about, you know, 'cause right. You think like, okay, let me breathe. What can I do to just reduce stress? But it has to be like, how can I support my body? 'Cause if I don't do it in a healthy way, then my gut gets, it gets like permeable. So it's like the lining of it starts to separate and then the bad bacteria goes through and the toxins come through and inflammation increases. And then our body's ability to respond is not as quick. and it just short circuits. So this is not just limited to this month, right? This is like an ongoing, we have to be aware and realize to take these baby steps.
Exactly, because the physical health changes, right? If we can't start taking care of ourselves and realize that it all factors together, there's physical ramifications that happen. And it's not just, you feed in coronavirus and the pandemic and even just the trigger of 9/11, right? What that triggers in people. And it's not just necessarily people that were involved in the incident and those families and can't imagine what they're going through, but just society, right? Yeah. It just opens up a whole new thing. We roll into holidays and what that triggers for people and stresses. And we roll into, it just keeps rolling. And time is going, I don't know about you, time is going so fast, like exponentially fast. And I don't know if that's because we're all inside. I don't know, but I find like it's warp speed.
Yeah,
but
it's Groundhog's Day also. So it's like the same thing over and over and over again. And you're like, okay, wait, what? It's Friday already? It's Monday.
Exactly.
It's Monday, Tuesday, Thursday. Like what day of the week is it?
All over again like that. Exactly. But we have to find our ways to limit the stress, right? To handle the stress. It's not that it's not going to be there, but it's having the conversations. It's having the ability to have that clarity to say, you know, if I can't get something done, it's okay. It's okay. Right. And to know that there's a difference of, this was really interesting. I was reading something about the difference of striving for excellence versus perfection. And perfection is a very downward spiral thing that does not exist, right? Because it's just a tunnel to shame and blaming yourself, where excellence is something that, yes, you can have, and it's more self-imposed of, I want to do something well, versus you're not going to be perfect and you're not going to be able to prove yourself perfect to anything or anyone. So stop waiting for that to ever happen. But also be gentle with yourself during this time and your family, and just realize that, like, you just have to be resilient and be in this together.
Yeah. Yeah. So he's saying about perfection. It also, when you're trying to be perfect, which so many of us do, or we try to, it that also leads to the procrastination, because there's that paralysis analysis of like, oh, if it's not perfect, then I need to procrastinate because it's got to be perfect, you know, and it becomes this whole cycle. And I was actually just thinking about in high school, my son, somebody bought him a t-shirt and it said, procrastinators unite. And then on the back, it says tomorrow. But yeah, you know, just getting back to your point of, you know, being gentle, why this is so important is that it just, it all accumulates in our bodies, right? And so we wake up one day and we go to the doctor and, you know, we're diagnosed with something like autoimmune diseases. There are like over 80 different autoimmune diseases. And they're like, the National Institute of Health has said that there's about 25 million people in America that have it. But then there's, you know, other stats that say there's 50 million, and like 1 in 9 women have it. It's just crazy. And then we think, wait a minute, I don't understand. I'm taking care of myself. How did this happen?
Right.
And it happened because it's just these slow little things with the stress, with the daily life that gets to us, and maybe not eating well, right? Or not sleeping well, not exercising enough, that it just builds up over and over time, that if you're not conscious, if you're not aware, you're going to wake up one day and you're going to get diagnosed with something. You know, it's, I'm not trying to be like morbid about this, but you know, you're going to get diagnosed with something and think, well, how'd this happen? Mm-hmm. So that's why it's so important to pay attention to both what we feed our mind and what we're feeding our body and how we're managing all of the stress.
What are the stats? I wanted to ask you, what are the stats on autoimmune? Like, I know like the 1 in 9 women and stuff like that, but go back like decades, because autoimmune wasn't a thing until really when?
The last few decades, and a lot of it happened with all the chemicals that were being introduced into products and with the toxins for the pesticides that were starting to get sprayed on all, because we went from being, oh, let's eat from farm to table, getting milk delivered. I mean, I used to have milk bottles that the milkman came every morning with a little crate with six bottles of milk, put it in front, glass bottles in front of our door because it was farms, you know. Right. But as we started to grow and proliferate, there wasn't enough food. So they're starting to figure out, how do I make more food and how do I genetically modify things? And then with that and things changing and women going back to work, our bodies are, we're starting to put things into it that slowly built up. So the autoimmune, like maybe one in 400 back in the 70s was diagnosed with an autoimmune disease. Right now it's like one in 12, one in nine, like the numbers just keep getting, you know, smaller and smaller. And it's kind of frightening to think, even if you look at obesity, it used to be it just for the overweight and for adults, right? And then it's like, no, kids are getting diagnosed with obesity and all these allergies and autism. It makes you wonder, like, to really stop and think, why? What is going on here? Right. What am I missing from the picture? And who am I listening to? And why do I believe things? And it's really, and the best time to start is now.
Right. And how can we get back? Like, how can we get so conscious and start listening to ourselves and start not listening to all that outside noise, as you were saying, like stop reading the, you know, well, start reading the labels and stop listening to the outside stuff and listen to your brain, listen to your gut, and really, you know, trust yourself to make those conscious choices.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, and as you and I always talk, you know, starting the day with the intention, doing a body scan, tuning in, mm-hmm. paying attention to the words that you use.
Makes a huge difference.
Yeah.
Yeah. Words do matter. And stopping, you know, when you do start to go down that negative, just like when you do start to go down that negative talk, right? Understanding to stop and pause and be like reset immediately.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, and I always love to bring it back to the movie, The Matrix, because, you know, that's my jam.
That's your thing.
Well, I do like to compare it because, you know, we don't know what we don't know. So it's like, you always have a choice. Do you want to take the red pill or do you want to take the blue pill? Do you want to stay in your world? That's fine. Right. Know that you're making a choice by doing that. But if not, and you start questioning why, then be honest with the idea that it's not going to happen overnight and it's okay. And as you were saying, you know, be compassionate, be kind to yourself, but just take one step at a time and realize you can take ownership back of your health, both physically, mentally, emotionally. And when you do, everything around you starts to change. You know, it's like you go from black and white TV to color TV.
Right. And that's in life, totally, right? That's relationships. That's everything. That's work. As the three C's go, right? There's a choice, chance, and change in there.
Yeah.
So it's taking time to assess that, because you do have a choice at any stage. You do have that ability.
And I think with that, that's a great way to end this segment, the choice, chance, change.
You always have a choice to take a chance to make a change.
Yeah, absolutely. As always, Robin, I love unpacking lunch with you every week. Choice, chance, change. See everybody next week.
See you next week.